The ones of you with a really good memory, you might remember we had Neil Thompson on the bill for BAFF game a few years ago, I think 2009, 2010, when you were at Bizarre Creations. But that didn't happen that year, but we, Neil promised he'd come back, and we've he's a man of his word, and we've held him to his promise, and now he's at the mighty BioWare. So he's flown in from Canada, Edmonton in Canada, to be with us today. So I'm delighted to be joined by Neil Thompson, art director, head art and animation director at BioWare.
Close
enough. To come in, be here at Bradford to join us. So welcome, Neil.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here. A couple of years ago, I really wanted to come, but circumstances beyond my control kind of stopped that. It's great to see so many people, you know, and it's been a wonderful conference. You know, I sat through Lucas's talk yesterday from Bethesda, and that was absolutely fascinating. And my son and I are big fans of the Lego stuff, to see how that stuff was made was great as well. For those of you who are BioWare fans, Mass Effect, Dragon Age, I am not going to stand up here for an hour and discuss the ending of Mass Effect 3, I'm afraid. It is what it is. What I am going to try and do is, Tom asked me to come and kind of talk about my, his words, illustrious career. I think by illustrious that means long. I don't think I've made enough money for it to be truly illustrious, but I started in games in about 1987. I know I don't look that old, but I really am. And ever since that point, people have been saying, why don't you get a better job? Games is all about embracing change, or why don't you get a proper job, I should say. And so what I want to give you is kind of my overview of how the gaming, the visual arts of games have progressed and evolved over the course of my career. And it's not going to be me standing here saying, then I did this, and then I did that, and then I did that. It's just kind of, I'll kind of pick out the various points from the companies and the platforms that I worked on, and try and pick out some examples of the graphics and movies that I think are important that have got us to where we are today. So, let's crack on. That's my gaming CV. I've got a little laser pointer here. Kickstar 2, that was the first one. Revenge of the Mutant Camels 2, anyone remember that one? Is there anyone here who was actually born in 1987? That's pretty pitiful, really. There's some fascinating stuff here. We're going to dip into a couple of these on the way. Wipeout is obviously everyone played Wipeout, I hope, right? Surprisingly few. Okay, well, maybe disappointed. And right up to Mass Effect 3 and Dragon Age Inquisition, which is the latest one from BioWare. That's me in 1987. As you can see, I am virtually indistinguishable from the young man there. The eagle-eyed among you may notice that is a floppy disk. That is a joystick. That's actually a mouse. That's the corner of a disc box. And that's John Buckley, who is still around in games today, all these years later. And that's a mustache, which you don't see so often. Okay, what are we going to talk about? So these are just some ideas. I'm going to pick on these randomly because I don't have any notes. Games is a valid artistic medium. That's a big one for me. I see games as an art form, and I think you should too if you are in visual arts. It is a medium like any other. It's like film, it's like photography, it's like traditional art, like sculpture, like anything you can think of. It's a medium. Computers are just an expensive brush. It's a medium for you to express yourselves creatively. And I think that's key to everything that we do. And it's key to the progression of games as an accepted art form by, you know, the establishment, the artistic establishment particularly. My illustrious career, that's kind of a side note. Career progression, I think this is interesting because we're a very immature industry. We've only been around
30 years.
30 years, let's say. And no one's really retired. Unless you made a ton of cash somewhere along the line and just on a beach somewhere, you won't find anyone who has worked from leaving university or school all the way through and retired at age 60 or 65. So career progression is a big deal. It may not seem it, you know, when you're starting out, but it becomes more important, you know, as you go forward. The role of academia, I think that's absolutely important, and where better to be able to discuss that than in a university. I probably won't make any friends with what I'm going to say on that one, but we're going to do it anyway. Hardware transitions, that's all about game. Working abroad, if anyone's interested in what it's like to go and work in a different country, I kind of know what that's like. Indie versus publisher-backed development. Yeah, business of making games, yeah, whatever. I've got one slide. BioWare and why we're great. Because we are great. Not in an arrogant sense of why we're great and we make great games, why it's a great company to work for and why it's a really inspiring place for me to be. The need for a broad inspirational palette, if you take nothing else away from this afternoon's talk, take that away and we'll discuss that in detail later. And it's something that Lucas was talking about yesterday, which is hugely important. And if we want to get into it, the future of the interactive medium, but who cares? Games as a valid artistic medium. So, I'm an artist. You can tell I'm an artist because I wear lots of black. I will talk in an overly pretentious manner about art because I think it's my job to do so. And I think it's your job as artists to think like that too and to be pretentious and to be artistic and to enjoy the visual world around you. So, what is art? I thought did you ever think you'd see a slide like this at a game symposium? The expression or application of human creative skills and imagination, typically in a visual form such as painting or sculpture, producing works to be appreciated primarily for their beauty or emotional power. That is art. Beauty. Oh, sorry. My clicker's gone mad. My clicker's broken. Oh, there we go. Beauty can be characterized by charm, harmony, simplicity, and radiance and symmetry by the art critic Edmund Burke Felding. So, can you think of anything more simplistic and beautiful than that? And is there anyone in this room who doesn't know what that is? Anyone at all? So I would suggest that by that, this is a culturally relevant piece of art. Right? It may only be, I don't know, 40 pixels in total, but rarely has an image resonated so broadly across the ages. Because this was the first kind of game that I saw. When I was growing up in the, certainly when I hit my teenage years in the 80s, the arcades were first becoming a big deal, and these were the games that I played. And what I'm going to try and do over the course of this talk is to sort of answer the question, if this will work again, of how we got from here as an interactive screen to this and to this. Okay, so how did I start out? I left school in, when did I leave school? About 1986. And I wanted to be an artist. And I didn't really play a lot of games. My father's a mathematician and he had a BBC Micro that used to sit around at the house and we played Elite and Zalaga and games like that. And we used to go to arcades and play Space Invaders and Galaxies and so forth. But I had no idea that that was a valid career, or a viable career at that point. It just didn't even cross my mind. So I left school to become a traditional illustrator, and I was painting and drawing. And, you know, I either wasn't very good at it, or there wasn't a market for that kind of work, because I struggled to make money, and I think I sold like 2 paintings over the course of a year. So I was pretty disappointed with that. And I ended up working in a carpet shop in Manchester, which was not really the heady heights of the artistic career that I had in mind. But it just so happened that one of the directors of, the son of the owner of the carpet shop was a director of A&F Software. Now, A&F Software, if anyone remembers, wrote the game Chucky Egg. Does anyone remember Chucky Egg? Yes, quality game. And he said to me one day, why don't you come along for an interview? And I went along and I took my traditional portfolio of sketchbooks and canvases and so forth, and I sat down with the directors of A&F. And this was in a... So you got to remember, in the late 80s, the industry was not the size it was today. It was a cottage industry. And Lothlorien was in a shop, basically. There was a row of shops, and one of them was an office, and there was like 20 guys in there, 20 nerdy guys, writing computer games. And I showed up with all this stuff, and they hadn't seen anything like that before, because it was still the coders doing the graphics. And they offered me a job, and they said, can you draw a spaceship? And I went, yeah, I can draw a spaceship. And they said, well, here's £4,500 a year, off you go. And I was pretty happy. So, to try and put it into perspective, this is my life as shown in a graph. I was born in 1969. Where are we now? About here. This is when I got into the industry. How exciting. And these are the pieces of hardware that I've worked on. There's one noticeable absence there. Well, there's two, actually. I haven't put PCs on there, but there's a notable absence. I've never worked for Nintendo or on a Nintendo platform, which I only realized when I was putting this stuff together. So if you're a Nintendo fan, I'm sorry, I'm not going to talk about that stuff. If you want to look at it another way, that's the next generation of consoles, by the way. There it is. If you want to look at it another way, here's the companies that I've worked for during my time. Some of those you may recognize, some of those you may not. I'm guessing most people will remember Psygnosis. No? Yes? No? Yeah? You got for that? No. Sony? Boo. Bizarre Creations? Everyone knows Bizarre? Oh, no, I assume everyone knows Bizarre. So I'm going to take you through and we'll pick out some stuff. So Lothlorien. These are the first graphics I did. I did that telephone box. I did that breeze block. And I did the guy on the bike as well, although kind of this is a long time ago, and I had to surf the internet to find these pictures, so you'll forgive me if memory fails. But it was, the Amiga had just come out, but we were still developing games on the Spectrum. And I was using D-Paint, which is a wonderful piece of software and has yet to be beaten as far as I'm concerned. And we used to draw in two colors, and then the procedure for getting the stuff across onto the Spectrum was that you would turn the Amiga off, turn it back on again, and then they had like a big serial port. You don't get serial ports on computers anymore. And they used to search through the VRAM, scroll through the VRAM and just take a snapshot of the graphics out there in two colors. It beggars belief, trust me. I mean, you cannot believe. That was Chucky Egg on the Amiga. Did anyone play that? No, you're lucky. I did the egg there. Now, so here's the problem, right? I didn't really understand what Chucky Egg was meant to be. Now, what the game is meant to be is that you're a farmer collecting eggs, right? And they said, right, we're going to do a 16-bit version on the Amiga and the ST, draw the central character. So I kind of took a more literal interpretation of the title, and I drew him as an egg. I also drew him with a baseball cap that said not on the front, because I was listening to Anthrax at the time, and if you remember, Scott Ian used to. And he has baseball boots on, but you can't really tell on that side. This was my only foray into C64 graphics, and it's a game called Super Trolley, and it looks horrible. And I make no bones about it. We did that game in about 2 weeks. But cultural relevance here, it was done based on an idea that a kid wrote for Jim Will Fix It. So there you go, 3 degrees of separation, right? So you're never too far away. I did not meet the man, so just make that as a point of record right now. Finally, the game that Lothlorien was most noted for and the game that I was most proud of during that time was an Amiga game called Nevermind. This we did independently for Psygnosis, and it was an opportunity for me to work in 32 colors rather than two, which was great. And it was a kind of cool puzzle game. Does anyone remember it? Anyone? You're not missing much, but there's some videos of it on YouTube if you want to have a look, and it's quite good fun. But what this gave me was the first big step in my career. So this got me to the notice by Psygnosis, and it was an opportunity to go and work with these guys up in Liverpool. So, you know, I cannot overestimate the importance of Psygnosis, not only in the games industry and in my career, but in 3D gaming as we know it today, right? Some of the stuff that was going on at that company in the early 90s is so important from a visual perspective, and so important from how they were trying to push the boundaries of the medium, that just has resonated to this day. Because if you remember, at this point, all games were 2D, pretty much. There was the odd 3D game. It was a title screen followed by the game. There was no intros or anything like that. And it was Psygnosis that first started pushing that idea. And it was an artist called Jimmy Bowers, who now works in post-production, actually, down in Soho. And he was so far ahead of his time in terms of this work. He was using 3D packages like Sculpt4D on the Amiga, and he was thinking of things in a filmic way. So he wasn't interested in the parameters of the machine and what he could or couldn't do in terms of palette. He had a vision in his head in what he wanted to see, and he used whatever was to hand to make that happen. So some of the videos we're going to look at in a minute, you look at them now, and quite frankly, they look. But at the time, it was absolutely groundbreaking. So just bear that in mind, and the movies get better as we go along, so don't worry about that. So Psygnosis just did a huge amount of games. I think people forget how many they really did do. Because most people remember them for Lemmings and Shadow of the Beast and Wipeout in the later years, but there was just a huge amount of stuff going on. And a lot of this stuff was an opportunity for artists like myself to really get into 3D and do these intros and these cinematic vignettes and so forth. I really start to push the medium a great deal. So the ones we're going to talk about today mainly are Wipeout, because it's incredibly important, and a little bit of Microcosm, because that's kind of where it all began. Does anyone remember Microcosm? Yeah, I'd be surprised if anyone did, but it's interesting. Bear with me. You can't talk about Psygnosis without talking about Wipeout. But it started somewhere, and the germs of that idea and the visual language of that game started a lot earlier. And it was basically down to software. So does anyone remember seeing this on a daily basis? So that's the startup for the Amiga. So when you turned on the Amiga, that's what you got, insert disk. And the software that we were using, click, there we go, was D-Paint, which ironically enough was published by Electronic Arts in those days, and of course now I work for Electronic Arts, but coincidence. Wonderful piece of software. It looks unbelievably dated now. It's a 320 by 240 was the resolution of the screen. You had 32 colors from a possible palette of 4,096, that's on the Amiga hardware alone, which basically meant you used, if you were working on the Amiga and using 32 colors, you used 16 shades of one color and 16 shades of a complementary color. And that gave you the kind of, all the games of this period are known for that sort of look, and generally we pick blue and gold because they look cool together. But from a 3D perspective, we were, don't do that. We were using Sculpt 4D. Now, I'm sure most of you use things like Max, Maya, yeah? Or are familiar with those packages. Sculpt 4D was a rendering package on the Amiga, and you could build stuff polygonally, but there were no texture maps. You had two types of surface that was Phong shader or matte, which just meant it didn't have the circular white highlight on it, and that was basically it. And it took, I don't know, if you had any kind of complexity in the model, it would take literally days to render a frame out, so it was kind of tough. And there was some point along the line that Ian Hetherington, who was the boss of Psygnosis, really got excited by what we were doing with Amigas and with 3D. And if you've seen games like Killing Game Show, which was the first one by Martin Chudley, who later started Bizarre, there was a lot of 3D stuff in the intro. And everyone got really excited about this and could see the potential for how this could go forward into games. So they started investing in Silicon Graphics machines. Now, does anyone remember Silicon Graphics? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, they were awesome, right? These machines were incredible. And they cost, some of the big ones were like £20,000-£30,000 a shot. And Hetherington, to his credit, invested a huge amount of money in kitting out all the artists at Psygnosis with these machines. And, you know, I was, very early 20s, and I'm allowed to swear, right? I swear? I was like a pig in, right? It was absolutely brilliant. We just played, and they set up an advanced technology group that was myself, Jim Bowers, a couple of other guys, and we just played, right? And we just, what can you do? What can you do with these machines? And we were running Soft Image, which is the forerunner of XSI now. And we picked Soft Image. We went around and we were looking for what 3D software we could possibly find, and that seemed to be, it seemed to be the most easy to use and what it could do. But it allowed us to use texture maps and start thinking about lighting and atmospherics and all this kind of stuff. And there it is. So if you imagine how these screens compared to our Sculpt 4D ones, it was a huge jump ahead. You could do it ambient lights. It's great. So I'm going to try and get to I'm going to get to Wipeout, because that's a very well understood game and a very well understood aesthetic. But you can't talk about Wipeout without talking about Microcosm, because this was the first game where we started to combine the stuff that we used the Silicon Graphics machines for in a 3D sense, with both live action and sprite stuff, and it was the first kind of game that was created in that way. And it was released on, the best version was on a Fujitsu FM Towns machine, which has long since fallen into the mists of time. I doubt if there are any left in the world, really. But it was quite a cool machine. And at the time at Psygnosis, we were messing around, a lot of hardware companies were coming to us with their hardware and saying, well, what can you do with it? And the FM Towns was one of the first ones that had a CD drive in it. And of course, with a CD, you can store huge amounts of data compared to a floppy disk. So when we were rendering stuff, you know, it's obviously very, there's a lot of memory involved. It's a huge memory footprint. And we could store it on the disk and pull it off quicker because it's a laser rather than a physical drive. So, how did Microcosm come about? And it was kind of a cool game. Oh, actually, I should mention that we did this thing called a fractal engine demo, and it ran on the towns. And if anyone's got a copy of that, I believe it's worth quite a lot of money now. And it was, it wasn't a game, it was just a series of sequences that were done by the art team then, just blown onto a disc. And it actually went to number one in the Japanese charts, even though it was essentially just movies. And when you look at it today, some of the movies are pretty poor. But it's getting the ball rolling, right? That's what you got to understand. So, let's have some movies. Right, so I was preparing for this talk, and I found a VHS tape in a box that I don't think has been seen in 25 years, 20 years at least, and it certainly was never seen outside the Psygnosis studio. And what it is, well, there were several things on it, and some of which were just horrible. But the two things I've picked were, we were talking to LucasArts at one point about, and this is before they started doing the game, so it was Lucasfilm actually, it wouldn't have been LucasArts, I don't think they existed then. And they were talking to us about, what could we do anything for Star Wars? So we did a demo. What we did is, it's some kind of CG elements using Amigas and Sculpt 4D, so it looks pretty rammy, mixed with some live action stuff that we ripped from the film. So, bear in mind, this is in 16 color. It's on a 320 240 screen, and it's very, very early, so it looks incredibly dodgy. But it'll give you an idea how things started. And then second up is the same thing, but for Terminator 2, because we were talking to... Who did Karolka?
Sorry?
It's Karolka, right? That was the production company, yeah. I think so. So before Terminator 2 came out, they gave us a big Digibetacam tape with some of the rushes from the film, and we had that locked in a safe in the storeroom, and we digitized some stuff with a Genlock on the back of an Amiga, and it's the same sort of thing, but the T-1000, T-800? T-800, the Arnie one, is built in soft image, so you'll be able to see a jump between the Amiga stuff in Star Wars and the silicon graphics stuff in the T2. And so. Logo was done in deep paint, by the way. All right, so grab from the film in black and white. That's a freeze frame with CG stars in the background. The Millennium Falcon I built on Sculpt 4D, and it was a pleasure to build. The lasers were just added on at the end. You can see there's no texture maps on that Millennium Falcon, it's just different shaded polygons. The typer, obviously everything that isn't a human being is rendered. Yeah, that was it. And that took like weeks to render. So again, this is all in deep paint again. That's a CG scene. That's obviously live action. Yeah, it blends seamlessly, doesn't it? There's the T-800 that was built. Yeah, don't laugh too loud, come on, it wasn't that one. This was cutting edge at one point, I tell you. I tell you what was fun was building the pistons on the T-800. That's fantastic. Have you ever got into constraints in IK skeletons? It's really good fun. So yeah, and that was it, right? So that's, I don't think anyone's seen that for years. Oh, just a little bit that was on the end. So this is this is the Silicon Graphics chip. Okay, so that's that, right? And it's a blend, yeah, state of the art, yeah. That was actually on the tape, right? So yeah, we were nothing if not ambitious. So there's a blending of rendered stuff and live action and just into a little motif. So the next one, we were talking about Microcosm. So Microcosm, we kind of took it to the next level. So we had the CG stuff, and we wanted to do an ambitious intro. Now, there was a couple of people who've played this game. Has anyone played it? Do you remember the intro? You're going to love this, right? If you like that, you'll love this. So this is an intro, and bear in mind, we didn't hire actors in those days. So all the parts in this are played by the dev team. There's a particular, and the voiceovers were done by, I have no idea, they hired someone to do the voiceovers. And they're horrible, I mean, they're really bad. There's like this Woody Allen voice. But there's some interesting people to watch out for in this, which I'll point out as we go along. So this is a blend of the Silicon Graphics CG, some live action stuff, all put back into deep paint, so it's all in 16 and 32 colors. So apologies for the quality. I had to find this on YouTube because this stuff's just gone. You know, I'm talking about archiving and all this stuff just has vanished, which is a shame. Yeah, the frame rate's not great either. I think this version was actually grabbed off an FM Towns by someone. It's actually quite long as well, so if you get bored, just tell me, I'll flick through it. But it's quite fun. So all this is CG again, as you can tell. The way we did the live action figures, because there's us in this, is that we didn't understand what a blue screen was. We knew kind of what it was, but we didn't know what it was made out of. So what we did was we went to B&Q and got a huge roll of blue paper and then hung it up on the wall, and we shot people against it with a handheld camera, and then someone wrote a program to extract, you know, chroma key it out. And then what we did was take that and map it onto a polygon, stick a polygon in the scene. It's pretty cunning, right? Laugh at your high-resolution graphics now, don't you? And if you actually see a 320 by 240 square on a regular PC screen now, it's like an inch across. It's crazy.
Sector 1, do you see anything yet? Negative, Command. There's nothing going on over here.
I think that's John Harris, who runs Red Hound Games, if anyone has worked with
him. Make sure that area is clear. Yes, sir!
This isn't the funny bit, right? That's Nicky Westcott, who did a lot of Wipeout 2097.
Sector 3, check ground level area.
Hey, I see something.
If anyone's familiar with the movie Escape from New York, you'll probably recognize a lot of these shots. Context as well, this is about 1993, 94 maybe, so yeah, this stuff was still cool in those days, things like chicken walkers. I should point out, the point of microcosm is that you go inside this guy's body, right? It's like a kind of Fantastic Voyage type of thing. So the medical helicopter is bringing the body in. The guy in the orange jumpsuit there is Nick Burkham, who's the designer of Wipeout. He now runs Playrise Game. I don't know if anyone's come across those guys. This guy about to come into focus.
The transport.
That's Paul Franklin, who just won an Oscar for the effects work on Inception. It's true, right? This is his proudest work, though, clearly. Okay, now we get to the good bit. So again, all the scenes, all the sets are CG. The figures are just mapped onto polygons in the scene. So we had to be very careful about how the scenes were rendered and how the guys were
shot. Well, Dr. Knowles, are we ready?
Mm-hmm.
The injection.
Yes, into the cephalic vein.
Not having any Woody second Allen, thoughts right? about this. Not getting a little nervous.
So the guy on the right is Jim Bowers.
This
the guy on the left is Lee Karras,
place.
Who was the studio art director
at
Liverpool.
For ignoring my
Sony
brilliant
Liverpool.
Ideas.
Well, if that's the case, you won't mind me bringing a couple of friends in, just to make sure things run smoothly.
That's Mike Waterworth, who was at Bizarre Creations, now at Lucid Games.
Gentlemen.
I'm sure you can recognize that guy with the lovely long hair.
Say hello to the good doctor.
Nobody else was supposed to be here. Security could easily have noticed them without my verification.
Look, stop complaining and get on with the job in hand.
See, that's a
then
performance.
Then we can all go back to Axiom.
It's method, you know. I don't actually have that tattoo. And into the body we go. So I think you'll agree that's a stunning piece of work by any standards. Oh, yeah. You know, and we were immensely proud of that at the time, and we thought that was pretty cutting edge. You know, it's dated, right, as everything does. If ever there was an industry where things dated poorly, computer games is it. So how did that kind of evolve into Wipeout? So all that work and all that, those ideas in terms of rendering in 3D and so forth were taken on, and Jimmy and Nick Burkham sat in a pub one night and drank a lot and came up with this idea for a future rally. And they went away and came up with this. And I'm pretty sure not many people will have seen this either. We actually thought that was very cool, actually, because we were going CD technology, right? So it's the owl is a... Yeah. It's interesting listening to the music on this. So this is 94, 95, maybe? Recognizably Wipeout ships, but if you're familiar with the Wipeout universe, it's aesthetically very different. It's very dirty, it's very grubby, and it was originally envisaged as a kind of future rally, not the kind of very clean cut sort of Formula One thing that it became. And that was the first thing, and that's what started it all. And then what happened next, if I can advance the slide, was that we were approached by a film company. There was a film called Hackers. Anyone remember Hackers? And they asked us to recreate that game within the film. So this is what we did. So again, it's recognizably the dirty aesthetic that's been fleshed out with a world, and there's some more, you know, there's the missiles and so forth.
That's a nice score for a girl.
Think you can do better?
They could have been in the microcosm.
I'll give it a shot.
Could be joining them up.
This kid bothering you, Kate.
Sorry, can I get some room here?
Yeah, why don't you come up here?
He's in the zone there, I think. This was done before the game was written, so the game was kind of in development, but it was in development for 7 years. Let's move on from there. And then, of course, the game was written. It had a great advertising campaign. That's Sarah Cox on the left, the DJ, in a previous life. And I don't think you could get away with this kind of marketing anymore. You know, that there was a huge thing at the time about the capitalization of the E, because it was the dance culture and all that kind of stuff. Absolutely intentional, obviously. Oh, are we in? And of course, then the games evolved as they did. But I think what's interesting from this slide is that you look at the first one and the way the cover, it's all Designers Republic artwork and so forth. And I think still that is the most unique in terms of an aesthetic and fashionable statement, right? Because it was very much of its time, and it wasn't a cynical marketing ploy, you know. We were young, and we were going out, and we were going to these clubs like Cream and so forth, and dance music was huge, and we liked the Designers Republic because they were doing the logos and graphics for the acts that we like and the CDs that we bought, and that's why it looks like that. You know, this is beautiful artwork, right? Yeah, look at that one. But I don't know, I still think that's the quintessential cover. Anyway, so I left Psygnosis in 97 and I set up a company with Nick Burkham, Lee Carrison, a couple of other guys called Curly Monsters, because we thought we could do it independently, and we didn't really like the way that Psygnosis was going. It was growing, it was getting too big, and so on and so forth. And so there we are. We did a couple of games. We did Engine Racing, which was kind of a playing game. That's us, by the way. That's Lee, Chris, Nick, Andy, Linky, some ugly dude there, some Redshift stuff. And the first game we did was going to be Engine. Now, when we pitched it to Infograms, we called it JetX. It's kind of an interesting story, right? So we left Psygnosis, and we were originally going to go and work with a publisher called Gremlin in Sheffield. They've long since disappeared in the midst of time. And Ian Hetherington, who'd now left Psygnosis because they'd been bought out by Sony, called us up and said, no, don't do that. I'm going to fund you, and I'll get you a deal, and let's talk to Infograms. So there was a very memorable meeting where the six of us went to a pub in Alderley Edge in Manchester, and we met Ian, and he wrote us a check for £250,000, literally, and gave it to us. And that's the most money I've ever had in my hands, and it was great. And we took that money and we bought Ferraris. No, we took that money and we put an office together, and we bought desks and we bought slogan graphics machines, and we started funding development. JetX was the first. It was going to be kind of, you know, like the Red Bull Racing stuff they do with planes, but it was before that. They weren't doing that yet. And the idea was that you're racing planes and you're going through these kind of timing gates to make sure you stay on the course, because obviously in a plane you can go anywhere. And we thought it was pretty cool. So I've got the intro here, and we can take a look at that. It was on the PlayStation 1. So it's interesting to see the evolution of graphics here, right? So this is maybe a couple of years beyond the original Wipeout. That's a logo that you don't see very often anymore, I don't know. And that's a guy you don't hear too much about anymore. He insisted that we put that on. So Bruno Brunel was the head of Infograms, and every game that came out had to have that on it. I didn't see Neil Thompson presents on any of these games. The idea is it's a racing league with planes, kind of like Wipeout, but...
She's 300 feet. She's intercepted localizer 7 right. Radio altitude 800 feet. Sync is under contact for center.
5. So I think it's a bit of an evolution from what we'd seen before. Where are we? No, go back. So we were pretty happy with that game. It didn't sell very well, but we were still pretty happy because six guys wrote that game in about a year. We started looking at a second one, so we were going to make the landscapes more realistic. We were going to go with physical gates on the next one because we thought that would be cool if you crashed into them and stuff. And there we are at the launch party with, Matt Dairy, the DJ. Does anyone remember him? Yeah, he had a window of opportunity that was not very big. But it was good times, right? And we thought, success, money, fame, everything. Yeah, didn't work out quite like that. Infograms didn't want to do a sequel, and basically they just said, right, forget it, you're history. And we didn't want to give up that easily. We thought we worked well together. We thought we'd done a perfectly respectable game. But we thought the best way to kind of go on was to really maximize the Wipeout connection, because we were the guys who'd done Wipeout, right? So we thought, well, let's play on that. So we came up with a concept called Neon, and we did some concept art. Hello? There we go. And we put together a little design document with lots of rendered shots of what we thought it was going to be like, and it was our future racer. And we started talking to Microsoft about it, and they wanted a futuristic racer for the Xbox, because the Xbox was about to get launched. And they wanted something like that, and why not get us to do it? So off we set, and they gave us $1 million, right? And you can't even get like a week's worth of development for $1 million these days. But we're six guys, and we grew the company to nine, ultimately, to do this game. And we had this vision of this kind of really sleek, futuristic, realistic racing game, kind of like Wipeout, right? But an evolution of that. We thought it was cool, the neon name, and it was all high tech and stuff. Now, here's the danger of working with a third-party publisher when they're funding development. They call the shots. It's their money, they call the shots. So this is the cover of the game that shipped. If anyone thinks this is a nice piece of art, we'll fight about it outside, okay? But wait a minute, that's not all, right? So this is a piece of, and I'll go on record as saying that. But it's not all. Check this out. They were so lazy they photoshopped in one of my concept ships into their horrible image. Right? It's just. It was a disgrace, and we were desperately unhappy, and they realized that, and actually after release, they allowed us to put out one of the other images onto the web that you could download and print out and put in as a substitute cover for the game. So let's take a look at the game. They also wanted to, so they picked this kind of cartoon aesthetic as well, so this is the only intro that we didn't do. This was put together by Microcosm under their art direction. We had nothing to do with it. So it's got live footage from the game and then some questionable work. Called it Quantum Redshift. Yeah. So this is what happens. You sell your soul. But anyway, we're good, right? We're doing a game for Microsoft. Money in the bank. It's going to sell millions. It's a new platform. Set up for life. Yeah. Kind of didn't work like that. And we got to a point with Microsoft where we'd signed a contract for two titles. They didn't want to do the second one. It didn't perform very well, which I thought was a bit unfair because it was a solid game, right? If you can go on and pick it up for like 10 pence, I think, and have a go on your Xbox. It's a good laugh. So anyway, so where does that leave us? We ran out of money. We couldn't get another deal. There was only nine of us, and we needed to grow the company to really survive. So I went back to Sony, which was Sony Liverpool, which was Psygnosis. And by this time, so 5-6 years had gone past, they'd evolved, they were now doing sports titles, and they're doing Formula One, as well as Wipeout. So I went in, and I took a bit of a step down. I went in back in as just a senior artist. To be quite frank, I'd got married at the time, I had a young family, a mortgage to pay, and I needed the work, right? So I went in back in as a senior artist and worked my way back up to art director, and I art directed in the MD, the Formula One franchise. And it was, you know, a lot of people who've been in the industry for a long time will talk about halcyon periods of development where everything just worked and it was great. This was the time at Studio Liverpool. It was there was about a 3 or 4 year period where it was a really close-knit team. Everyone loved what they were doing. We were really passionate about the games we were making. I'm a big F1 fan, so working on the game was just a hoot. We were talking about rebooting Wipeout, because they'd kind of done Wipeout Fusion while we were away, and it wasn't particularly good. So they'd given the franchise a rest, and they were coming back. F1 was brilliant. I got the opportunity to go and meet all the drivers when we went to scan them. That's Fernando Alonso being scanned, laser scanned, for the meshes on the head. They had to do it with their eyes closed. They weren't happy about having lasers shone in their eyes before they got into a Formula One car and drove around the track. I don't know why. And it was exciting, because we were working on that. And that's a PS3 development kit. And the PS3 was about to be launched, and we got an opportunity to get our hands on it early on and start really, you know, taking it apart and seeing what we could do. And you can do a lot, as we discovered. You know, if you consider where we were at 20 minutes ago with our frames, this is an in-game shot. You can see all the lighting is much more realistic. You know, there's no texel damage or anything like that. The textures are huge. The shaders are great. The lighting is much more impressive. There's realistic reflections on all the cars. You know, it's so far away from those games that we talked about in the first days, it's hard to imagine that it's even the same medium, right? And it's only in the space of 15 years, right? We were able to do damage. These are all screenshots, by the way. It's not renders, it's nothing like that. These are all screenshots from the game. We had a really good damage model that we were messing around with. And one of the problems that we came up with was, because it's very CPU intensive to destroy things and break them up, what would happen in the worst possible scenario if all the cars drove into each other on the grid? So we set it up as a test. And this is like 5 seconds long, so if you blink, you'll miss it. But it's basically all the cars on Monza self-destructing at the same time just to test whether it would slow down. And it's kind of cool. So yeah, and we did that. And the Formula One franchise was very successful. We started the reboot of Wipeout. We did Wipeout Pure on the PSP, and it sold bucket loads. It was a really good game. And the design aesthetic had moved beyond the old days where it was kind of dirty and distressed, and now it had this really clean, kind of futuristic look to it. We were using the engine that we developed for the Formula One series, so the lighting is great. The introduction of zone mode. This was primarily the work of two artists, Rita Lindsley, who's a concept artist, and she's just phenomenal with color. And also a guy called Cole Fawcett, who was the art director of the Wipeout. And he unfortunately died this year, which is pretty sad, really, because he was a lovely, lovely guy. And I don't know anyone who didn't think he was their best friend. But he left us this legacy, and I think it's important that we remember that. This is Rita's work, beautiful again. That's obviously not an in-game screen, but it was the kind of work that was going on around it, so expanding the aesthetics of Wipeout into different areas. So let's have a look at some Wipeout.
We'll be right back.
great. Everything's happy. Everything's great.
PlayStation.
PlayStation. So then Sony made a kind of, they made a very sound business decision, actually. They acquired Evolution Studios and Big Studios. Bye. Am I boring you? And I kind of fell out with the management of Sony at this point, and I wasn't altogether happy with the way that they were developing and how the studios were progressing. And if you get into that situation at work, you can do two things. You can either suck it up and sit there and take the money, or you can walk, right? You can walk and believe, let your actions dictate your beliefs. So I left and I went to Bizarre Creations. Does anyone remember Bizarre Creations? Yay! Bizarre Creations are a great company. They were a great company. And I'd known Martin Chudley for a long time because he used to work at Psygnosis way back. And we knew a lot of the guys there. And I called them up and said, look, I'm interested in coming over to work for you. Is that okay? And they were like, yeah, come on over. So we did. And the two games that we did while I was there were Blur and the James Bond game. Now, Blur was a fantastic experiment. If ever there is a forgotten classic, Blur is it. And I urge you to go out and buy a copy of this game. Preferably on the Xbox because it's the best version, and you can pick it up for like a fiver. But seriously, it's a hoot. And the idea was to take Mario Kart and put it into real cars. Now, I have theories on racing games about why they're successful and why they're not. And my belief is that racing games have to have a high aspirational element to them. It's got to be a car you can't afford to drive, in a location you can't afford to visit, and preferably doing something that's illegal or you're not meant to do. So if you take a game like Need for Speed Hot Pursuit, you're in Lamborghinis, in exotic locations, and you're breaking the law. So it nails everything, and it was very successful. Unfortunately, Blur didn't have the top mark cars, as in M-A-R-Q rather than K. It didn't have the Ferraris, it didn't have the Porsches. The best it had was the Koenigsegg, which is a Swedish supercar, and I just don't think you go in there and you're driving a Ford Focus, and no one really cares. And it was also asking you to kind of do this sort of disbelief factor that there were weapons involved as well, like Mario Kart. And I thought it was a beautifully made game, and it's a very, very pretty game. Chris Davey was the art director, and we worked for a long time on getting this aesthetic to a point where everything sits comfortably. And it is very pretty. But it didn't sell. But let's have a look at it anyway. It also came out at the same time as that game by... what was it called? The other racing game. That truck you saw there with Ford across the front, I never knew what that was until I moved to Canada. And then you can't move for them. It's a Ford Raptor, and they're huge, and everyone drives them. It's brilliant. Obviously, again, this is all shot from the in-game engine, manipulation of the camera, but it's all real time. I also thought the logo looked a bit too much like the band logo. Maybe it's just me. It just confused people, right? People didn't know what they were buying, and it wasn't marketed very well, and it just got confusing. And at the same time, Bizarre were also developing James Bond game Bloodstone. And it's very difficult, as anyone in games will tell you, to have a studio that develops two different IPs at the same time in different genres. It's very, very difficult because quite often they don't share technology. And Bizarre had just done The Club, if anyone remembers The Club, which was pretty well received, and it was a good game. And they used that engine and those mechanics to do Bloodstone. And I loved making Bloodstone. And I thought we made a really good job of it. So we're going to look at a movie here. And it was a Bond game. Bond games don't tend to sell very well apart unless they're called Goldeneye. But this is another. I wouldn't tell you it was a good game if it wasn't. I know when a game is a stink, right? And this is a good game. It's also, there's a great movie on YouTube where someone shows how you can complete the game by just kicking people in the nuts, which is great.
You give up your secrets.
What you notice about this as well is that we'd started to get into grading, heavy screen grading, which I know Lucas was talking about yesterday, and we were really messing around with the final frame in terms of its aesthetic. So it's got that kind of steely green look to try and reflect Bond's personality.
No, this isn't over.
It's hard to believe. So we completed that and we were pleased with it. Jumps ahead. That's bad. So here we are. So we're doing the press tour. That's me with Golden Gun, the actual Golden Gun. Nominee for best game at DEF CON. That's Nick and Dave and Adam at the launch party, sipping Bollinger as you would expect. That's Joss Stone. She was in it as well. So we thought, yeah, great, right? This is more success. Yeah, doesn't work like that. Activision, in their wisdom, decided to close Bazaar a couple of years ago now. And of course, we were all desperately unhappy about that. Still surprises me that decision was made, because I think Bazaar had a lot to offer. But as far as I was concerned, then it was an opportunity to move on. And now people are going to get disappointed with me because I'm not going to talk loads about BioWare. We're going to go on to other things, okay? But I got an opportunity. This is how it's a good example never to make enemies in the industry. So Alistair McNally's the senior creative director over at BioWare, and he and I had worked at Psygnosis Manchester about 15 years before, and we were very close friends. And kind of while I was at Bazaar, and even before that at Sony, we discussed the idea of maybe going over and working together at BioWare, but it just wasn't the right time. And then Bazaar was closed. By that time, I was divorced. And I thought, well, go for it, right? It's probably one of the premier studios in the world. I mean, maybe top three. Fair, I think, to say. And over I went, and it was absolutely fantastic. So that's kind of my career. But thank you for listening. I appreciate it. I've gone pretty long. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.